Hi guys, it's Claire. Welcome back. Today I wanted to talk about Where Reasons End by Yiyun Lee, which is a book that came out earlier this year and which consists of a series of conversations between a writer and her 16-year-old son Nikolai, who has recently killed himself. And this book is a novel, but its central premise does bear similarity to Yiyun Lee's own life. Like the narrator of this book, Lee is a writer who has also lost her oldest child to suicide. So I don't think it's too much of a stretch to say that this book is in some measure autobiographical, or at the very least, that it could be read as part of Lee's attempts to grapple with her own experience of loss and grief. And in this novel, Lee is far less focused on telling a linear narrative story and more immersed in exploring the extent to which words and writing and language can help us approach an understanding of loss and tragedy. And it got me thinking about other books about grief and loss, and specifically books about writers writing their way through grief in order to achieve or create or arrive at a kind of meaning or acceptance or catharsis in the midst of what is an otherwise swallowing void of loss. And so I wanted to look at a few different books that I think are interesting examples of this kind of writing and compare and contrast how they use the written word as a means of confronting grief. And I wanted to start this discussion not with Where Reasons End, but instead with Blue Nights by Joan Didion, which is another book about a writer grappling with the loss of a child. And I wanted to start with this book because I think out of all of the ones I have here, it is perhaps the most conventional book about loss. And I think that's because Didion does to near perfection what so many books about grief strive to do or end up doing, which is to kind of enshrine grief in beautiful language, to put it in a kind of amber, and to seek control and refuge and understanding through the act of writing. And while Didion's other famous book about grief, The Year of Magical Thinking, could be read as her attempt to chart a rational path through the irrationality of death, Blue Nights is about the death of Didion's daughter Quintana, and it is a much more fragile and nostalgic and deeply sorrowful piece of writing. And in addition to exploring the void left behind when a child is lost, this book is also steeped in regret and anxiety about aging and frailty and the terrifying, inexorable passage of time. Towards the beginning of the book, Didion describes what she calls the fading of the blue light. In certain latitudes, there comes a span of time approaching and following the summer solstice, some weeks in all, when the twilights turn long and blue. Suddenly, summer seems near, a possibility, even a promise. During the blue nights, you think the end of day will never come. As the blue nights draw to a close, and they will, they do, you experience an actual chill, an apprehension of illness at the moment you first notice the blue light is going. The days are already shortening. The summer is gone. And the language throughout this book is so beautiful and stunning and demonstrates that absolute precision that Didion commands in all of her writing. But as she grieves the passing of the best days of her life, and as she becomes increasingly physically frail, she also starts to express a certain anxiety that her facility with words is also faltering. What if my new inability to summon the right word, the apt thought, the connection that enables the words to make sense, the rhythm, the music itself. What if this new inability is systemic? What if I can never again locate the words that work? For Didion, writing provides a clarity and directness that serves as a kind of bulwark against pain. It allows her to control her vulnerability and contain her grief. And you can feel her doing this throughout Blue Nights, repeating certain phrases and images in a focused and restrained way that approaches poetry and allows her to do kind of two things at once, which is to transform her grief into something moving and poetic and sublime, while at the same time reducing her grief to something comprehensible, to mere words on a page. And it's clear that for Didion, writing is a means of survival, but throughout this book you also get the sense that her desire for control and catharsis falls somewhat short of the truth. Throughout the book, she writes around the uncertain circumstances of Quintana's death, and Quintana herself remains this void of regret and misunderstanding that Didion never really seems willing to try to penetrate. And so despite the beauty and elegance of her prose, and despite how emotionally affecting this book can be, I do think that the act of writing only carries Didion so far and leaves certain more complicated truths untouched and unresolved. Which brings me to Where Reasons End, which, in contrast to Blue Nights, is far more willing to explore the extent to which language almost always falls short. Where so many books about grief and loss seek to construct a kind of greater meaning or an explanation for the inexplicable, Where Reasons End is remarkable because Yiyun Lee, as a writer and a thinker and a mother, is far less interested in arriving at a place of catharsis or resolution, and is much more willing to follow various paths of emotional inquiry to uncertain ends. Like Didion, Lee turns to language in the face of her grief, but where in Blue Nights you can feel Didion striving for strength and control, Lee's narrator is constantly unpacking the roots and meanings of various words. She's considering which words have taken on new meaning or significance or insignificance in the light of Nikolai's death. And Nikolai, for his part, is always berating her for the ways in which she leans too heavily on metaphor or cliche. And so although she relies on writing as a means of approaching truth or understanding, Lee is also always aware of and acknowledging its inherent limitations. And I say approaching truth because what makes Lee's writing so singular is the extent to which it is unwilling to compromise or provide tidy answers or reasons where none exist. Lee has absolute integrity to the truth, even when the truth is something she can't access. And so instead of the beautiful lines and images that are repeated and take on poetic significance in a book like Blue Nights, what you get in Where Reasons End is Lee constantly questioning the extent to which meaning is constructed and how much of any kind of meaning is actually true. She writes, "Only in an O. Henry story does the last leaf take on an existential significance. Only in an O. Henry story does everything come with a poetic and tragic twist. The truth is, leaves are always falling. After a while, they all look the same." And because Lee is so honest with herself and with the reader, Where Reasons End can sometimes be an emotionally frustrating read because there is no clear sense of narrative or catharsis. But at the same time, what makes Lee's writing feel so revelatory are the ways in which she is willing to explore certain contradictions, although she admits the ultimate futility of language, saying that no amount of words can fill the void left by Nikolai. Still, she writes and has faith in the value of writing. She writes, "Words fall short, yes, but sometimes their shadows can reach the unspeakable." And so Lee approaches grief with an absolute willingness to surrender to that which remains unspeakable, and yet, at the same time, she maintains her faith in that very human impulse to explore and explain and understand. And that human impulse to write through grief and to chase after truths that may remain elusive is also the driving force behind a book like The Sorrow of War by Bao Ninh, which is a novel about the Vietnam War that, like Where Reasons End, would seem to be quite autobiographical, or at the very least, deeply informed by Bao Ninh's experiences as a soldier fighting for the North Vietnamese. And The Sorrow of War is a slippery, surreal account that follows protagonist Kien as the narrative circles between his life before, during, and after the war. And one of the most striking images in this book is that of a forest that is described as being haunted by the souls of those killed during the war, death and blood having soaked into the roots of trees that now groan and howl with the cries of the dead, forever echoing and retelling the same horrible stories over and over again. And in many ways, Kian himself is much like that forest, his life stained with the blood and trauma of a decade-long war, and his mind and spirit constantly unsettled and reverberating with the voices and memories of the dead, friends who have died, people he's killed and seen killed. And in the years following the war, Kian finds himself holed up in a room in Hanoi, writing a feverish, elliptical, often alcohol-fueled account of his harrowing years as a soldier and the grief that has smothered and shaped much of his life after the fact. Nin writes, "There is a force at work in him that he cannot resist, as though it opposes every orthodox attitude taught him, and it is now his task to expose the realities of war and to tear aside conventional images. There is no escape, no savior to help him. He alone must meet this writing challenge, his last duty as a soldier." And so, when he writes about his grief, Kian does so as a soldier, propelled by a sense of duty to attest to the agony and horrors of war, and to arrive at a kind of truth that someone like Yiyun Lee chases in her own way. And like Didion, Kian and Bao Ninh also seem to write as a means of survival. They cannot not write about what they've been through. But unlike Didion and Lee, the grief that Ninh writes about is not just Kian's personal, private grief. Instead, it is a grief and sorrow that is tangled up in politics and governments and national traumas. And so he is not just trying to write his own truth, but instead the truths of thousands of civilians and soldiers who can no longer speak for themselves. And in that way, his grief serves as a kind of witness to both individual and collective suffering. And that idea of witnessing and collective grief is also central in a book like Men We Reaped by Jesmyn Ward, which is her memoir of the untimely deaths of five young Black men who she grew up with in the Gulf Coast community of DeLisle, Mississippi. One of those men was her younger brother Joshua, and in this book, Ward, like Nin, uses writing to turn her private grief into a kind of public testimony. Witnessing and giving voice to the agony and injustice felt in her community, but too often suffered in silence. Because although in so many instances death can feel ludicrous and unjust, for Ward that feeling is particularly acute because of the social and political forces at work in the Deep South that make the deaths of these young men feel both incredibly preventable and devastatingly inevitable. She writes about a great darkness that bears down on her and her friends in the Black community, a menacing shadow that looms over their lives and tells them that they are nothing, even as they try to outpace it. And so this book is, in some ways, part of Ward's attempt to push back against the idea that these young people's stories and destinies have already been written for them by forces outside of their control. And the way she writes about each of these young men captures beautifully their intense vitality. When she describes her memories of them, their specific personalities and gestures and rapport and relationships with the people around them, those passages of the book sing and radiate a warmth and a love and a vibrant youthfulness, so much so that when you learn how and when these young men died, you feel the full blow of it and the tremendous, infuriating, gutting loss of it. Ward describes this book as, quote, "the narrative that remembers, the narrative that says, hello, we are here. Listen." And in writing about her grief, Ward is not only paying tribute to these young men, but also reanimating them beyond mere statistics. And although Ward, like Yiyun Lee, is wary of approaching loss and injustice with a desire to find meaning and resolution where none may exist, she too believes in the power of writing and in the value of writing down people's stories. Toward the end of the book, she says, "I write these words to find Joshua, to assert that what happened happened in a vain attempt to find meaning. And in the end, I know little, some small facts. I love Joshua. He was here. He lived. Something vast and large took him, took all of my friends, Roger, Demond, CJ, and Ronald. Once they lived. Writing cannot perhaps bring people back or grant true peace or right wrongs, but it can assert that people like the five men she writes about were here, that their lives should and do matter. So clearly all of these writers have very different objectives and philosophies when it comes to grappling with loss and grief. And I think it's interesting to compare and contrast their different priorities and approaches. So I would be curious to hear your thoughts about any of these books or books about grief in general, or what kind of writing about grief you find most moving or compelling or enlightening. So let me know your thoughts in the comments below, and as always, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!